It's time for the Bill Ferguson Show.
Buenos dias, mis amigos. This is Phil Ferguson, and you are listening to the Phil Ferguson Show. Yes, my adventure of learning Spanish continues. Steady as she goes, my target is within 3 to 4 years to be pretty much fluent. I took about 8 or 9 years to be able to feel like saying that in Italian, but I have learned a lot about learning a language. And so that helps quite a bit. And also, I do get to cheat a lot because there are a lot of words in Spanish that are similar to Italian. And I'm having fun learning the differences between Spanish Latin America and Spanish Spain. And of course, even in Spanish in Latin America, often there's a lot of words, a lot of different words in different countries for the same word, the same meaning. So it's a good fun thing for me to do in the very limited free time. Often when I'm out for a walk or stuck driving in my car somewhere, I'm practicing that. But you're not here to hear all about that. That's weird English, here to hear. Coming up in the show, we've got a couple follow-up segments. I have a follow-up on the annuity discussion that we had in the last episode because the listener sent me some more details. It doesn't materially change anything, but it does give us some more details about how that specific annuity works. And by works, I mean how it gives you next to nothing and pulls more money out for the insurance company than you will ever get. That's awesome for them. A small follow-up on the steak dinner discussion that we had, a little information about the company that ran it. I don't think I gave the name. It's not materially important because, you know, they're probably just a normal old registered investment advisor and do a lot of the things that other advisors do and a lot of things that I don't do. I have my own unique way of doing things, in part because I never, ever, ever worked for a brokerage firm or a different registered investment advisor. So I don't have the baggage of thinking that certain things are good. Each thing that comes to me, each possible investment scheme, strategy, product, whatever, I have to evaluate it on its own merits, and it has to beat the really basic strategy of stocks and bonds and index funds, and so far they don't. And of course, our special guest today is Objectively Dan. He is a host, creator, producer of Truth Wanted, which is an ACA product, Atheist Community of Austin. So we're going to talk all about that and my appearance on his show, his YouTube video show. It's not just audio like my little thing is, but we had great fun talking to some guests that called, and you can watch that. And I don't know, maybe you'll find it amusing. Maybe you'll like it. Maybe you won't. He is much nicer than I am when talking to people that have interesting ideas. Yeah, I'm less tolerant, and maybe because I've done this longer, but who knows. The other thing I want to get into as an impromptu, because I got this email last night and wrote up a bit of a response, and so I thought, hey, again, I just did all this work. Why not throw it in the show as a little segment? And my apologies, if you like short shows, this is not going to be one. We're probably talking 90 minutes plus, so buckle in. Anyway, this listener sent in and was asking questions to me about the idea of shorting stock. And someone that they know has shorted the Donald J. Trump stock. And of course, It is an idea that popped into my head. It's an idea that popped into a lot of people's heads. And apparently, a fuck ton of people have taken action on it and have shorted the stock because everything Donald Trump does turns to shit. And there's no reason to think that this won't. Even if Donald Trump wasn't involved, a stock that was trading at 3,000 times its annual revenue is ridiculous. On its face, it makes the Tesla overvaluation at its peak look like a novice. It is absolutely staggering. And as of now, the stock is down something like 75% in 2 weeks, and every day is another 5, 10, 15, 20% drop. I don't know what it's doing today yet, and I don't know what it will do in the future. But anyway, I'm here to talk about shorting as a general concept. So the weird thing about buying stocks, the normal way one buys a stock is called long investing. You buy a stock, you pay $80 for a share, and your hope, your dream, your fantasy is that at some point in the future, it's worth more than $80 a share, and you have made money, right? That's so straightforward and easy to understand. Even if you've never done any investing, I think that that works for people. There are a lot of very complicated ways to invest, gamble, risk your money, strategies, things that might make you money. You know, there's a fine line between making money and investing, because you could make money at a casino. You could make money at a horse or dog racetrack. Doesn't mean you're investing. You would be gambling in those last two cases. And you can gamble and win sometimes. It's a fascinating concept because gambling, generally speaking, is what would be called a zero-sum game minus an expense. So everyone that plays on whole makes nothing except for the expense involved in gambling. So that's that little percentage, whether it's 2% or 15% that the house takes. So the house always wins on average. Now, individually, you may lose, and then sometimes people win. But collectively, the mathematics, the game design is all set up so that the house, on average, always wins. So gambling is a zero-sum game minus the expense that goes to the house or the person controlling the game. The fascinating thing about buying stocks is they are a zero-sum game plus the appreciation over time minus the expense of playing, buying, selling, participating in the stock market. So there are still expenses, and you want to keep them as low as possible, but there is the expectation of having more money at the end on average. And again, a lot of stocks can go broke, can collapse, can fall down to penny stocks, while some other stocks do wondrous, amazing things and go up a lot over years. And it's easy to look at the ones that have won over the last decade, but did you know which ones were going to win this decade a decade ago? And that's the really big problem, because to have a stock that goes up many, many, many times, often you have to buy a stock when it's out of favor. Apple, for example, when things looked the darkest and it looked like they might not continue, that they would finally be crushed by PCs, they come out with iPods, they come out with phones, and their size just balloons and explodes. And most people didn't think that was going to be a thing. So that was when you wanted to buy it. But you don't have that information in advance, or at least you shouldn't, because that might be illegal insider trading. Anyway, enough about long stock investments. You want them to go up. A short, as one would imagine, is the opposite. You want the stock price to go down. Now, what you have to do is you basically have to see, even I have to pause to think about this, because you're not buying, you're selling the stock. So if you're selling the stock at $70, what you want to be able to do at some point in the future is buy it back at a lower price. So you sell it for 70, and in your dreams, at some point in the future, you buy it for 50 and you made $20 a share. Sounds pretty straightforward so far, but I am here to warn you, it is not. It is wickedly complicated. It is wickedly risky. And what I find, and the person that was sent me the nice email apparently is not doing this, but someone they know is, I am getting the distinct impression that they don't really know what they're doing. And that makes it dangerous, because there's a couple of things. In all cases, when you go to short a stock, you have to sell it first. So you don't buy it and then sell it for a higher price. You sell it first. Well, how in the fuck do you sell a stock that you don't own? You borrow it. And where the fuck do you borrow it from? You borrow it probably from a broker. And the broker could have those shares in their accounts because other people own them. And this is some of the crazy, I've used wicked too much. This is one of the crazy things about how it works, because people don't know. They don't think through the process of, oh, I'm just going to borrow a stock and sell it for $70. Well, where did you borrow it from? How did you borrow it? How is it that it could be borrowed in the first place? So if you're at Fidelity, for example, and you want a short, you have to open a margin account. You have to fund the margin account, and you are supposed to read and fully understand the margin contract. That's where a lot of people are going to fail, because they're just going to sign it and they're going to start playing the game because it sounds like a lot of fun, because it's a no-brainer, at least at $80 or $60 or $50, that the Donald J. Trump stock was going to go down. I mean, come on, really, we all knew that. But the details are, when you go to borrow the stock, it has to be borrowed from someone or some entity that has ownership rights to it or the ability to lend it to you. So as one could imagine, there is a limited supply of any given stock. There have been cases in the past, and I think this should be illegal, by the way. It should not be allowed. You can have a case where there are more stocks shorted, more shares shorted. Wow, tongue twister, mind twister as well. There are more shares that are sold than are currently available to be purchased, period. And weird things can happen when that is allowed to exist, when that situation exists. And so when you borrow that stock and sell it for 70, under normal conditions, your goal is for the stock, as I said earlier, to fall to 50. You buy it at 50. You give the share back to the person that lent it to you at 70, and you've cleared 20 bucks. Now, there's some transactional expenses, and there is probably an interest rate on the account, and it's probably a nominal interest rate today, maybe 7, 10, 12%. To have the money to borrow those stocks that you're selling. So the first thing to think about, and from my perspective, is we were talking about zero-sum games before. Shorting a stock and owning stock long, when shorting a stock, it is a zero-sum game minus expenses, and there's a lot of them, or there could be a lot of them, minus the probability that on average, while a lot of stocks do go down, a lot of stocks go up, and on average, the market goes up. So you're betting against the system while paying high expenses. So that's a very big risk. when you buy a stock long, our previous example, you bought it for $80. If it falls from $80 to $0, you can lose 100%. I say in jest, the nice thing about owning the stocks long is the most you can lose is 100%. There's a limit to your loss. If you put in $10,000, the most you can lose is $10,000, perhaps minus some expenses. However, when you short a stock, if you buy it for $70 in our example, and it goes to $200, right? You have to buy the stock on the market for whatever the market price is to give it back to the person you borrowed it from. I don't know if this sinks in. It is a crazy complicated thing. You borrow it and sell it for 70, and at some point your contract comes due and you have to give back the shares that you do not own. How do you do that? You buy them on the market. Remember, you were hoping they went down. And so your profit is limited to by how far down the stock price can go. But your loss is unlimited because the stock could go to $200 or $300 or $500. And this happened to a lot of people with meme stocks, where AMC Theaters, which I talked about recently on Facebook, maybe even on the show, and GameStop. When other people are in the market manipulating the stock and not acting as rational entities, the price could do almost anything. And so if you short something and it goes up, you have to buy it at the higher price. So if you buy it for if you sell it for 70 and it goes to 200, you have to come up with the money to pay $200 a share so that you now own a share and you can give it back to the person you borrowed it from. I'm hoping this is clear. It's a complicated thing, but the short of it the too long didn't read answer is that you have unlimited risk if the stock price goes up. What can also happen in a short situation, well, there's many things that can happen. One, if the price goes up high enough, the person that lent it to you in the first place for you to sell it at $70 may call or close your position. And they will say, I'm sorry, you've now lost more money than is in your account. And you may have to throw in more cash into your account to keep your position open. And that cash will be held until your position is closed and they see that you didn't lose your ass. If there's not enough cash left on hand and you can't add more cash, they will close your position for you. So if you bought it at 70 and it goes to 200, you don't have enough cash in your account, they say, I'm sorry. The risk for us as the brokerage firm is now so high that we are going to close your position. We're going to take all the money that's in your account, and you might still, on top of that, owe them more money. And they will come for it. You have to pay it. So it's a very risky thing to do. What can happen when a stock is heavily shorted is a thing called a short squeeze. And sometimes, in extreme cases, it's called a mega. The investment world likes the mega, a mega short squeeze. And what can happen is a lot of people have shorted a stock, as an example. Keep in mind this Donald J. Trump media company crap. It was not a unique idea for you to go short it. A lot of people had this idea, and a lot of people have shorted the stock. And the stock has fallen precipitously. So anyone that had a short at $60, if the stock is now $22, you could get out and make a lot of money. However, if you wait longer, if you think it's going to go to zero, you'll make even more money if you wait longer. However, there may come a point where some people say, hey, you know what? I don't want to take the risk anymore. I'm going to get out. And so they buy the shares on the market and give them back from whoever they borrowed them from. if enough people start doing this, if the supply of that stock, the number of shares, is limited, and keep in mind, Donald Trump owns something like 60 to 65% of them, and so do some other people own large percentages that, as of yet, they can't sell. So the supply, the trading volume, is very thin. That's the industry buzzword. So all of the sudden, you have a lot of people who want to cover their short positions, buy the stock, and give it back to whoever they borrowed it from. If that happens, the price of the stock could, for a short period of time, spike ridiculously, because there are people who are desperate to cover for the shares that they borrowed. So people start getting out at 20, 25, 30, 35, 45, 50, 60, and you got in at 60, and all of a sudden you're like, okay, this is not working for me anymore. I want to get out. You put your order in, but in that hour, that day, that moment, whatever, so did a bunch of other people. Even if you went with some clever things like options and puts and calls, they might transact that day, but they might end up getting in a line, a backlog, and they only transact after the price gets to 100. So you bought in at 70, hoping to sell at 50. It went to 20. You didn't get out. And now you're forced during the short squeeze to pay 100 to cover your $70 position. So that is something where the risk is, like I said, really high. The other thing that happens is, as there are more people shorting a stock, brokerage firms have learned from their mistakes in the past. One example is Betterment, who halted new shorts on GameStop. Became a very big ordeal. And of course, all of the internets went crazy and blamed Betterment for screwing people out of their money. But at some point, they said, hey, wait a minute, we've lended out so many shares to so many people, and we're worried that those people don't even have enough money to pay them if a short squeeze comes, and then a short squeeze starts, and they stopped trading, and they have to pause and evaluate their risk profile. So to counteract that, a lot of brokerage firms will charge interest on your margin account. Often it's 10 or 12% or 15% or 18% or 20%. But they have the right in the contract, if that's what's in the contract that you signed, that of course you read and fully understood before you made your first transaction. And what is happening now with the Donald J. Trump is that so many people have shorted the stock that brokerage firms are now very seriously concerned that somehow they're going to get screwed on the deal. So they have applied a clause that's in the contract that you signed that your interest rate has changed. It goes to 80% or 100%. And the person that wrote me is telling me that apparently the broker that they're using, it could go all the way up to 725% fee, 725% interest. So if you borrow $10,000 for the year, you owe back $72,500. Actually, maybe $72,500 plus the $10,000. Yeah, I think I've got that right. So 7.25 times plus what you originally borrowed, you could owe $82,500. So again, the expense is wickedly high, or could become wickedly high. So if you short stocks for a living or have a lot of experience doing this, fine. Continue what you're doing. I wish you the best. However, if you're just an average person and said, hey, I've heard about shorting, I've read these meme stocks, and you thought to yourself, this is a no-brainer to buy this Donald J. Trump media stock at $50 or $60, or I'm sorry, not to buy it, to sell it, to short the stock because you're going to make a ton of money. The ironic thing is there's a good possibility that you will be right eventually, but you could get fucked in the meantime. There could be a short squeeze, and even if there's not a short squeeze, the interest rate on this money that you've borrowed, the stock that you've borrowed, becomes so comically ridiculously high that you still lose money even when you're right. I'm not interested in it. And if anyone asks me my opinion, I would say, don't play in this game. Get the fuck out. If you've already shorted the stock, if you have a way to get out now. There's not currently a short squeeze. If you made money or even if you've lost money at this point on a short, get out. If you don't know what you're doing, you will be the person getting burned. You will be the one funding the brokerage firm. You will be the one who gets bit in the ass. You don't want to be in this position. Okay, that's all I have to say about that. Let's take a little break and we'll go in with more of the Phil Ferguson Show.
Why do we have religion in the first place? Why are we having this discussion? Because we are pattern-seeking mammals. It's part of our evolution. We look for patterns. We're designed to look for them. And if we can't find a good explanation, we'll come up with a bad one, rather than none at all. Most people would rather have a conspiracy theory than no theory. It's very observable that. There's a lot of junk science around before good science arrives. Before we have astronomy, we have astrology. Before we have chemistry, we have alchemy. All of these things are derivatives of religion, because in a very sinister verse of the Bible that used to upset me when I was being forced to listen to it as a little boy, it says, seek and ye shall find. Yes, that's exactly right. Seek and you will find. Seek for an explanation of volcanic eruptions when you're living in a primitive society, and you will think they're probably a visitation from an angry deity. And if you're told you can postpone the next eruption by throwing a few live babies into the lava down the crater, that's what you'll do. Religion has just started. Religion has just begun.
The Phil Ferguson Show is for educational and entertainment purposes only. Nothing said on the show should be interpreted as personalized investment advice. Investments should be based on your personal situation, and you, of course, should consult with your financial advisor or tax professional before taking any actions.
This is a little bit of a follow-up on the annuity review that I did, I think, just the last episode. The prospective client for this salesperson, a listener of the show who shall not be named at their request, sent me some additional information that the salesperson sent them in an effort to provide motivation, I think, to buy the product and maybe incidentally create a little bit of fear. And the first thing that I have to say is that these look like they were copied on a fucking mimeograph. They've been copy after copy after copy. And there's all these notes at the bottom. Let's see. Past performance is no guarantee of future results. I can only read that because I know that canned statement. There's a lot of other stuff. I can't read it. It's smeared. It's blurry. It's out of focus. It's really fucking sad, honestly, that you're going to send somebody like that and the disclosures and the footnotes aren't there. But it's basically talking about what are the probabilities of you running out of money? And I don't know where this come from. I don't know what it's based on because I can't fucking read it. And it has, if you take out 3% or 4% or 5% or 6%, yada, yada, yada. And 4 and 5% are looking like you're 80 to 95% good for 25 years into retirement, which I think fits the kind of the way that I do it, because if you retire at 60 or 65, odds are you're going to do great. I just don't understand, even at 5%, if your portfolio makes nothing, you can do that for 20 years. So the trick is to either not lose money or have a portion of your portfolio that is it's a general drag on your performance in bonds, and you sell those when the stock is down and wait for the market to come back up, which so far in the past, no guarantee of future results. Every time the market goes down, eventually it goes up. You just don't want to sell while it's down. So that's one thing. The other stuff that the listener sent me is what are called illustrations. And these are absolutely fantastic. And I did look over this a couple of days ago, and now I'm going to re-review it with you.
to make sure that I am speaking extemporaneously, because that's the magic word. I am speaking extemporaneously. That has to do with the SEC examination that I had that ended in January/February, but started 6 months earlier. But made it through that. Yay. Wasn't really that bad. The guys were pretty nice. But this stuff from the annuity shows here single life level income. And of course, we know that the single life level income is going to last only as long as you have money left, even though it's called lifetime income. It's not for your entire lifetime. It's your lifetime or when you run out of money, which I think is kind of fraudulent. But this has to do with a theoretical contribution of $500,000. And then there's all these different time periods of how many years you wait to allow the account to grow. And let's say you wait 10 years, you put 500,000 in, and then 10 years later, you would have a income base of 1.2 million. Whatever. I mean, that's not the cash value. So if you say, hey, I've had this for 10 years, it's now worth 1.2 million. I want to end it and send me 1.2 million. No, my friends, that is not how that works. Now, this is the income base, and it's a fictitional thing. And like a lot of these things, they use whenever there's an extra word, like beginning of your income base, why not account value, right? So the account value is not guaranteed. The income base is likely to be 1.2 million. And then they have a column that says guaranteed lifetime income withdrawal, $57,000. So you could get $57,000 a year. Annual income, if combined, must meet eligibility requirements. I don't even know what that is for. So you could get $57,000 a year out of that account. Apparently, that's guaranteed. Of course, if you invested $500,000 and it turned into a million plus 10 years later, which would be a reasonable expectation for a broadly diversified stock index and bond index portfolio, you would probably get something around that same dollar amount. So that's not so terrible, awful. The problem, of course, here is that they then charge all kinds of fees and expenses. And I'm going to get to that here in a minute. Here's more stuff that we talked about last time. What's guaranteed? Regardless of market conditions, your annuity provides you with a minimum guaranteed contract value. And again, you know, that's an arbitrary thing. Death benefit, not as good as just owning taxable accounts. Tax deferral, just like you have in an IRA, a Roth IRA, or a 401k. And this was proposed to someone who was going to take 401k money and put it in an annuity, which honestly, I think should be criminal, but that's just me. It does affirm that the rate on the S&P 500 is 6.25%. Whatever. The nice thing is that the participation rate is 100%. So you do get 100% of the 6.25. I did not know that number before, but if the market goes up 10, you get 6.25 and you get 100% of the 6.25. Yay. Why don't I get 100% of the 10%? So you get 6.25. The fixed is 3%. The minimum guaranteed rate for fixed is 0.25. I had talked about the possibility of it going to zero. Apparently, that is not an option. So a slight positive correction that I needed had, but honestly, 0.25 is pretty darn close to zero, but I did say zero. I didn't know, I guessed. So there's that. Let's see what else we have here. I'm doing this. There's a bunch of different options, choices there. I think I wanted to get to this. Yes. They have a calculation of what the accumulated value might be. And it's a funny thing here, because this is also a really bad quality document. It's photocopied and it's distorted. There are lines in here that I literally cannot read. That's not acceptable. That's absolutely not acceptable. And so they have you starting with, I'm assuming 500,000, but I can't read that part of the page. And you save, oh, by the way, the on all of these, they show that after 20 years, you don't get any more money. Your account doesn't go up anymore. And so if you buy this 25 or 30 years before you want to start using it, if you buy it for 30 years, you're going to have 10 years where you don't make a fucking dime. You don't even have a chance to make a dime. They have here a possibility that you start taking out money at 59. It tells you how much you would withdraw. It tells you what the income base is. Complete fiction income base. Then it has accumulated value and minimum guaranteed contract value. What is amazing, those numbers fall precipitously because the money that they're paying you is your money, right? The account didn't make much, at least for you, it didn't make much. And the income base numbers that are here are fiction. And so if you start taking money out at 59, by the time you get to 69, the accumulated value is zero and the minimum guaranteed contract value is zero. The cash surrender value is zero and the death benefit is zero. So you could put money on this and let it grow for 10 or more years, start taking money out at 59. And if you have the misfortune of living 10 years, your beneficiaries will get $0 from the 500,000 you started with that could have turned into a million. The way I do it, it's kind of like, at least compared to this bullshit, you get to have your cake and eat it also. Because if you have a $1 million portfolio and you take out about 5% a year, you get $50,000+, depending on your age and when you want to start this, but you keep the $1 million. And so you could always take that money out and spend even more, or you could leave that $1 million to your descendants. If it's in a Roth, tax-free. If it's in an IRA, they can pay the tax and distribute it over 10 years of their choosing. If it's in a taxable account, they get a step-up basis on all of the appreciation and pay no fucking taxes. But here, if you live 10 years, not only will there be absolutely nada for your beneficiaries, you now run the risk that they're going to stop paying you the lifetime payments, as we discussed before, because your account value has gone to zero. And even the fictitious income base, another 10 years goes to zero. It doesn't matter that there's this column called income base. So there is a possibility that the annual or the lifetime withdrawals will continue if certain conditions are met, but it may stop if certain conditions are met. And let's see, 59 to 79, it projects that they might have paid you out $1.2 million, but if you had it invested, you probably would get around $1 to $1.2 million and still have the $1 million. And if you're lucky and you're taking out 5%, if your portfolio grows at 6 or 7%, it's bigger than what you started with. So just another way to look at how profoundly stupid this is. There's multiple riders that are discussed here and how much you could make. I'm not going to go through all of them. Don't want to beat. Let's see. Anything else? No, it's more of the same shit. Just it's different. Oh, I did want to take a look at this. Hang on a second, and I'm going to have to open up the S&P 500 numbers. 1 second. All right, you don't know it, but I paused for a minute to get to this page. I'm at wikipedia.org, S&P 500 historical data, so you can check for yourself, and that's one of the things that I like to do is I give you data. One of the things I also really like doing, and this is for me and for you, I guess, but I try to not cherry pick dates to give performance data. I try to stick to full calendar years because it's very easy for you to verify. And sometimes you can have a case where while the market is up for the whole year, it might have been up 30% by the middle of the year and ended up down 2% for the total year, but you could report that in 6 months it went down 30% or 32%. So I don't even want to tempt myself to cherry pick data, so I try to stick to years. There's different calculations here on how much your account could make. And I thought this was fascinating because they have historical index movement comparison, the most recent 10 years, the highest 10 years, and the lowest 10-year time periods. And I was pretty sure it said on here somewhere what those time periods are. Of course, it's just on the next page. Here we go. The most recent 10 years are the time period ending 12/31 of 2023. So just recently, that's nice. The highest 10 years are 2011 to 2021, only 2 years different than the recent 10 years. And the lowest are 2006 to 2016. And so that's one of those things that people often include that because it has the 2008 drop as well as the 2020 drop because it's 2016 is when it ends. So let's look at the lowest one and see all the protection that this thing gave you. Here's the lowest numbers contract year 1 through 10. And so it started in 2006. All right, so we're going to start in 2006. The, what do they call this column? At Wikipedia, S&P 500, total annual return including dividends for the S&P 500 for 2006. That number is 15.79%. The assumed rate of return, because they're looking backwards in time. So, I mean, back-tested data is misleading and very possibly negative or invaluable. The rate of return that they said you would have gotten with their thing is 3.1%. Market went up 15.8 and you get 3.1. The next year, the market's up 5.5 and you get 0.6. The next year, okay, this is a really nice year for them here, a fair year for you as the investment person, because the market did go down 37% in 2008, but you made 0.6%. And the reason you made 0.6% is because this particular model had part of your money in fixed, making something like 3 or 4%. So that's all that you got. So you know what? You didn't lose 37%. That's very nice. Now, the previous 2 years, you didn't make 5% and you didn't make 5% and 15%. So you missed out on the opportunity for 20, but you avoided a 37% loss. So using just those 3 years, this is a pretty fucking good deal, to be fair. The next year, it made 10.4, but the market went up 26. So now you missed out on 16, and at this point, you're even. The next year, it paid out 7.4, but the market's up 15. The next year, it paid out 1, the market's up 2. The next year, it paid out 4%, the market's up 16. The next year, it paid out 10, the market's up 32. And then the market was up 14, and it paid out under 5. So and then the last year, 2015, the market was at 1.38 and this paid 0.60. It says the geometric mean interest rate. I don't like that. Oh, 4.19%, but the annual growth rate net of charges, 2.64 for 10-year time period. During that 10-year time period, the 10-year annualized return of the S&P 500 was 6.94. I'm going to call it 7%. So you could have made 7% or 2.64% per year. So when I talk about annuities underperforming the market 4 or 5%, here's a perfect example. You could have made 7 or 2.64. So that's a loss of almost 4.5, loss of more than 4. Let us look at the highest 10 years, and the highest 10 years were 11 through 21, 2011 through 21, right? 2011. All right, I'm highlighting all this here. And it has the first year, Wow, this is great if it's true. The first year it has 5.5%. Was it really 2000? 2011. Yeah, 2011. The S&P 500 was up 2. So this annuity thing did fantastic, made 5.5 when the S&P 500 was up 2. The next year, of course, corrects for all of it. The market went up 16%. The annuity paid 9.4. The next year, the market's up 32.4%. The annuity made 7. And then the market was almost 14%. You get 3. Up 1%, and you still got 3 for the next year. Following that was 12%, and the annuity paid 12. Not so bad. And then there's a year where the market made 22%. And strangely, maybe these are offset a year different than what I think they are, but you get the idea. The annuity says 0.66%, and the market went up 22. And the last three here, they made 9, 9, and 6, and the U.S. market, the S&P 500, made 31.5, 19, and 29. Those are 2019, 2020, 21. So you could have made 30, 18, and 20, or 996. Wow, big difference. And their annualized growth rate net of charges for the best 10 years that they decided to show you is 5.22. And the actual annualized return for the S&P 500 during that 10-year time period, 16.55. Wow. So that is a loss of 11.33% per year. So if you started with $500,000 and you're losing 11% per year, that is $55,000. $55,000 per year that you're not making. It's probably bigger than that because it went up, right? So it's much bigger at the end than what you had when you started. So just some more information about what an annuity can do. And it sucks out several percentage points every year, limits your growth. It does protect you on down years. And we have that data. But let's see here. Since 1961, how many years were down? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17 times. So between 61 and 2023, it was down a few times, but that's 40, 50, 60 something years. So 80% of the time, 80% of years, it's up. And I even included 2011. Oh, which I shouldn't have, because the growth was zero, but with dividends, it was 2.11. So that year actually wasn't down. But some of the years are big downs, no doubt about it. But you also have, I shouldn't have counted this year. 1994 was up 1.32, not down. But then you have years minus 9, minus 11, minus 22, minus 37 in 2008. That's the really big one. So you are protecting yourself against that really short time period of a year or two, or maybe three, like around 2000. The market was down for 3 years in a row. Of course, it went up for 7 years after that, big correction in 08, and then up almost every year until 2021, only one down year from 2009 to 2021. So you're protecting against something that It's a problem, no doubt about it. But how much protection? How much do you want to pay for protection? And the end result is losing 4 to 11% per year in something like this annuity. And I think this is either stereotypical. No, that's a stereotype. This is typical of annuities, and maybe it's on the bad side. Definitely not the worst that I've seen, but definitely on the bad side. But I just wanted to give some comparisons now that the show listener was kind enough to give me illustration data, that we had actual data that they made up, hypothesized what the performance would have been through this back-tested data. And even with the opportunity to create and tweak, make something look better, it still looks pretty fucking bad. So that ends this fun segment.
You're listening to The Bill Ferguson Show.
When someone thanks God, I don't get offended. How many people thank God every time they say thank God? I don't get offended. Do I?
But you must be aware that a lot of people in America would potentially find that offensive.
What, because I'm saying I don't believe in God?
Yeah, because you're kind of mocking them, you know.
No, I'm not. I'm not mocking them. People's beliefs aren't my concern at all. I certainly don't differentiate between religions either. I look at all religions the same. Unlike religious people, I look at all religions equally.
The Phil Ferguson Show is for educational and entertainment purposes only. Nothing said on the show should be interpreted as personalized investment advice. Investments should be based on your personal situation, and you, of course, should consult with your financial advisor or tax professional before taking any actions. This segment is a very brief, I hope, I expect, I plan, a very brief follow-up on my free steak dinner, which I enjoyed immensely, if you didn't pick that up from the last episode. I did a little more research, not too much, but went to their website, found some regulatory documents that they have to file, the same kind of things I have to file, not a problem. Just wanted to add a couple of things here. I thought I highlighted something. Another page, maybe? Another page? There we go. Their fee structure is maximum of 1.45. And so that, of course, is for smaller accounts. And mine is one or less. Theirs is 1.45 or less. So 0.45% more, at least on smaller accounts. So there's that. And then it says plus model management fees. So they're going to get up to 1.45 as the advisor. And this is something that I've only experienced a couple of times before. Not that it's unusual. It's just that it's not part of my world. It's not part of what I do. A lot of financial advisors, they get the money for shaking your hand, answering the phone call, talking to you, you know, bringing up issues of concern, solving financial problems. And that's great. And I do those things too. But one thing that they often don't do is modeling, or in lingo of this show, something like the Polaris plan. They might figure out how much you should have in this or that account. And so for this company, the free steak dinner company, they charge an additional 0.25 to 1% as a model management fee. Now, they reserve the right to do the modeling themselves or to outsource the modeling. So that is something that I do all the time for every client. And so, you know, 1% or less. And this one is 1.65 to 2.45 is what you're going to pay. So, you know, just something to think about. They also had, where is this other part that I wanted to tell you? Ah, yes, here it is. Possible conflict of interest. They do claim to act as a fiduciary. Fiduciary? Why is that word so hard? But then they do things that I think exclude you from being a fiduciary. So, you know, what's the definition? That's a serious problem. This is under potential conflicts of interest, third-party payments. Some persons providing advice on behalf of our firm are registered representatives with an affiliated broker-dealer. These persons receive compensation in connection with the purchase and sale of securities or other investment products. Compensation earned by these persons is separate and in addition to our advisory fees. Then they have another similar one that's worded the same way, where someone might be registered with an insurance agency, and these people will earn compensations in addition to our advisory fees. So we're talking about 1.45 or less, plus modeling portfolio expense of 0.25 to 1%. And on top of those fees that you're paying them, they may sell you something like an annuity, a variable fixed annuity, a fixed annuity, a variable annuity. I don't know which things are going to count, but there is the potential that they're going to recommend products that pay commissions to one or more people in the organization. And one of the reasons I know that, well, I don't know. I'm very, very, they put this in as disclosure. So, I mean, this probably happens at some point. The thing that I thought was interesting is that their company, official documents that they file with the government are under a different company name than the one that they use in the marketing materials. Again, nothing technically wrong with that. I just found it odd, just like I found it odd that this guy claims to be so famous, but the company is not in his name. It's in his wife's name. Again, maybe he loves her and wants it to be in her name. Also, since they've only been married for a while, it's a newer company. And of course, he brags about the fact that he started three companies, one of which he said he can't talk about. I read into that something happened, and maybe that's why it's not in his name. I don't know. Not my problem, not my concern. It can be in his wife's name. That's fine. I also found out that in the documents where they have NBC, CBS, Fox, ABC, these little TV icons that he's been on these TV, it has a nice footnote that this may have been part of a promotional segment on those channels. So I looked into that a little bit, and it looks like there are companies that, like, I could hire for a fee, and from time to time they buy really late at night segments on, let's say, Fox Business, for an example, and they buy an hour of time, and you get a 5-minute segment where you get to talk about your business or some thoughts that you have, and now you can put technically on your materials that you've been on Fox Business Channel. So, I mean, it's technically true, but kind of sad. The other company that he said he had was about training advisors, which I didn't get that a whole lot. Why is he training advisors? How is he training advisors? He didn't give us the name of that company. So I don't have the information, and maybe it's totally legitimate, and maybe he made a YouTube channel, how to train advisors, and started a company to collect revenue from that, and therefore technically it's a financial services company. So he started three companies. One he can't talk about, the other one he didn't really talk about what they do, and then this one is in his wife's name. The other thing that I thought was interesting in the regulatory documents, the size of his business, and just as a reference, as a fact, Polaris Financial Planning currently has assets under management of around 124, depending on the day, because the market goes up and down. And it's just me. It's real lean expenses. That's why the fees aren't 2.45 plus commissions. But for him, it's him, it's his wife, it's a couple of other advisors, it's two office locations, at least one, if not two, receptionists, probably several clerical people. And all of those things cost an awful lot of money. And so I'm guessing that there's 8 to 10 staff people in his company and two locations and all the costs that go on with that. But their total assets under management are not twice the size of mine. And so that would leave a pretty small amount left over for the owners of the company, at least relative to how I'm doing. And so one of the ways to supplement that is this potential conflict of interest where you're not acting as a fiduciary when you and or someone else in your company is recommending products that have commissions. And again, these persons, compensation earned by these persons is separate and in addition to our advisory fees. So there's that. So I'm going to put this in the recycling bin, there it goes. We're done. We're done with that. And I hope that helped maybe learn a little bit more about the inner workings of the investment advisor industry.
You're listening to The Phil Ferguson Show.
Jesus says that he speaks in parables because the people, they just don't understand anything else. But the parables are often foggy and meaningless, and Jesus is snippy when even the disciples don't get them. He says to them, if you don't understand this parable, then how can you understand any parable? And are you incapable of understanding? I kept thinking, don't teach in parables then. It's not working. Even your staff doesn't understand them. Why don't you just say what you mean? Okay, so Jesus isn't so patient, and I think he picked a very ineffective lesson-giving technique, and he's angry most of the time, but that doesn't make him bad. It's just, wow, I really expected someone else. Some of the parables are not just foggy. To me, they're sort of offensive. Like in Luke, Jesus helps us understand God's relationship with humans by telling us a story about how God treats people the way people treat their slaves. They beat some more than they beat others. Okay, I know this was a different time and everything, and I really tried to keep that in mind as the Bible refers to slavery all over the place, and not only does it not say it's wrong, I mean the Bible gives you advice about how you're supposed to keep your slaves and how slaves should behave obediently at all times to their masters. But I don't know, I guess I sort of thought the Son of God would say slavery was wrong, but no, Jesus does not say that. In fact, he uses slavery as an example of how God treats people. It was really hard to stay on Jesus' side when he started saying really aggressive, just hateful things. Like in Luke chapter 21, Jesus says that he is like a king who says, anyone who does not recognize me, bring them here and slaughter them before me. Or in John chapter 15, Jesus says, anyone who does not believe in me is like a withered branch that will be cast into the fire and burned. In Matthew, he says, I come not to bring peace, but a sword. And in Luke, he says, and if you don't have a sword, sell your clothes and buy one. Then Jesus just starts acting downright crazy. Like in Matthew chapter 21, when this fig tree doesn't have a fig for Jesus to eat, he condemns the fig tree to death. That's right, Jesus condemns a fig tree to death. Not a parable, by the way, just Jesus pissed off that the fig tree didn't have a fig for him to eat when he wanted one. Not exactly the Prince of Peace who taught us to turn the other cheek. And then there's family. I have to say that for me, the most deeply upsetting thing about Jesus is his family values, which is amazing when you think how there's so many groups out there who say they base their family values on the Bible. I mean, he seems to have no real close ties to his parents. He puts his mother off cruelly over and over again. At the wedding feast, he says to her, woman, what have I to do with you? And once, while he was speaking to a crowd, Mary waited patiently off to the side to talk to him, and Jesus said to the disciples, send her away, because you are my family now. Matthew, Mark, and Luke all tell this exact same story, but Mark actually tells us why Mary was there to see Jesus. He says Mary came to see Jesus to restrain him, because the people were saying he's gone out of his mind. I kept thinking, yes, let's go get Jesus and get him some help.
Welcome back, everybody. And as promised earlier in the show, we have Dan, or Objectively Dan. How the heck are you, sir?
I'm doing great, Phil. How about yourself?
Excellent, excellent. And I don't know if all my listeners will know, but I was just on your recent little YouTube-y thingy, Truth Wanted, a product of the atheist community of Austin. So it's not your show per se, but you're on it quite often, I think.
Yeah, I did start the show. I am the creative producer, and I basically am the guy behind the scenes running stuff, as well as being on it. I used to be the only host for most of the show's lifetime.
Yeah.
In the past few years, I now rotate with some other hosts. But it is a product of the atheist community in Austin, as you mentioned. I do some other shows too, but that's probably the one I'm most known for.
What other shows do you do? This is your chance.
Yeah, I'm a host on Talk Heathen as well, which is another yep. atheist community of Austin show. I do not produce for that one, so I don't nearly do as much work for it, which is great. And then my most recent venture is I have a live stream that I do with a guy named Prophet Azad, and we call it Zodanza. And we're live every Thursday at 9 Central, and we react to videos, we do fun activities, we just do all kinds of stuff, and it is a great time. So those are my three big projects right now.
Excellent, excellent. And I don't know if you want to give any backstory. I mean, were you religious, raised religious? Were you born an atheist? Well, everyone is. But what's the story there? Did you have to struggle your way out?
Yeah, so I think a lot of, before I was doing Truth Wanted, I think my biggest online notoriety, I guess you can call it, was I was in a video of a guy named Anthony Magnabosco.
Yep. I'm sure you're familiar with. I know him well, yes.
I think he's been on this show. So, you know, Anthony does this thing called street epistemology where he talks to people basically on the street about their epistemology, right? Epistemology being the study of knowledge, how we attain knowledge, methods of knowledge, but also just like when people say they know things, what do they really mean when they say that, right? So he's interested in asking people these conversations, and he had a conversation with me when I was still a Christian lad. I grew up in a Christian home. I grew up in Waco, Texas. And grew up in a kind of half Baptist, half Methodist family. It's kind of complicated, but I was definitely super Christian. And in college, I was in a college ministry. And in that video in particular, I had just started as a leader within my college ministry. So I actually helped ran small groups and stuff, believe it or not. So there's a 30-minute video of me when I was like 19 talking about how I thought God was awesome. So kind of funny how it ends up on the other side of the...
Now, is that here. Just a... an interesting point, or did it have something to do with loss of faith?
Well, I think when people tell my story, I think they want to say, oh, this is where you lost it. But no, I didn't. I was still a Christian for a while after that. And I was also deconstructing a little bit beforehand. But especially in Baptist circles, you're not really supposed to talk about when you're doubting, right? In some instances, doubting is a sin, but more often than not, it's just kind of frowned upon.
Backsliding times, kind of thing. Right?
Yeah. If you're asking questions, you don't do it in front of the congregation. You do it behind closed doors, or you do it in a group of people you could trust, right? So like when I was on camera, I remember I told Anthony that I 100% believed. I don't think that was true. I think that was me kind of posturing a little bit. I was already kind of deconstructing a little bit. I think that was, I described that moment as a stepping stone in a greater path of deconstruction. And I use the word deconstruction. I know it's very popular these days, but I think it's a good representation of what my beliefs were. Cause I didn't go straight from Christian to atheist. I kind of did some loop-de-loops, you know, went to a few places before I wound up where I am today. It was definitely a stepping stone on that journey for sure.
Well, I am positive that somebody, when one does street epistemology, eventually you're going to run into somebody you're going to help deconvert. But I've also heard people argue, and I think it'd be great if we had data. Does street epistemology simply convince people to change their confidence level? Or does it really actually change their confidence level? I mean, are they just reporting a lower number? Did you report a lower number after your half hour, or were you still 100%?
That's a good question. I don't remember if I reported a change. I actually actively protested. I remember actively protesting the idea of putting a number to my faith, because obviously that's a very modern idea. Right, putting a percentage like that. I don't think traditional Christianity really accounts for that. So I didn't really. My strategy there, I guess, was to not play the game.
Yeah,
in
yeah,
some
yeah.
sense. Yeah. But no, it was more like I think internally I was really thinking about some stuff. I don't think the idea though is, oh, you're going to convince somebody's mind completely by the end of a conversation. One, I don't think that's ethical. But two, like I think about it like this, right? When you go to therapy, you never just go to one therapy session and suddenly all of your problems are gone, right? And you've fixed everything in your life. It's more like a process of self-discovery in some instances, right? Part of, I mean, good therapy, right, is talking through your issues, but maybe more importantly, getting the tools to figure out how to solve some of your issues, and working with somebody who can help you not only be accountable towards your goals, but also just help you define those goals in the first place, right? So in that sort of mindset, I think street epistemology can be helpful in that sense. I think it can be great for an ongoing
right.
sort of help for somebody. I don't see it as, oh, we're going to evangelize you to atheism or whatever, which I think is a pretty common mischaracterization. Obviously, you talk about data. I know Anthony has been working hard with trying to get real numbers on how street epistemology can help. And I know he's been trying to reach out to people. I don't think he's been successful with that so far. I can only speak anecdotally to my own experience. And the fact being that, of course, street epistemology is heavily influenced by Socratic questioning, which is,
right.
I mean, it's as old as Socrates, right? People have been doing that for a long time. So there's probably something to that, you know?
And you used, what was the word you were deconstructing? Is that you said?
Yeah.
And
are you familiar with the phrase?
I am, and I know what it means, but it really wasn't used that much until the last mm-hmm. couple of years. So mm-hmm. I'd love to hear what you think it is, as the guest, of course, and what happened during your deconstruction?
Yeah, so I pick up the term deconstruction because before I became an atheist, Phil, I became a progressive Christian.
Uh-oh.
Okay, so you gotta understand, yeah, I grew up around conservatives. I would have called myself a centrist. I took one of those political compass tests in high school and I got like right dead center. Okay, so I would say I was centrist on a lot of issues, but really a lot of people who say they're centrist are also, you know, conservative in some right. ways. I was definitely conservative in a lot of ways. So like that sort of, but you know, when I was deconstructing my faith, right, I was also deconstructing some of my political beliefs and stuff too. And so like, I changed to being a progressive Christian first before I became like a progressive atheist, right? And so in progressive Christian spaces, there is an entirely different landscape, Phil, than what you see in like, you know, the stereotypical evangelical church scenes and stuff, right? There is a whole sort of other wave of Christianity that's been kind of brewing. Of course, it's always been a thing in academia, but it's become more common in the mainstream now that there's podcasts, you know, and YouTube channels and other influencers out there. And so I was kind of more involved in those progressive Christian spaces. And they like to use the word deconstruction because a lot of them are still Christians.
Right.
Right. They are still profess a belief in God or however they, you know, define their own Christianity, but they may not be the same kind of Christian that they used to be. And a lot of times it's most often it's coming from a more fundamentalist understanding of Christianity to a less understanding, a fundamentalist understanding of Christianity. And so I like to use that word because when we say deconvert, it sounds like you're changing like everything in your life, just like flipped a switch almost. Like, oh, suddenly you dropped all of the cultural baggage that comes with Christianity or all of your ideas of morality or all of your ideas of this and that, you know. And like for me, it wasn't that. It was a general process. And I think deconstruction sort of outlines that, yeah, that is an effective process that happened to me. Now, of course, I'm an atheist now, yeah. And I'm more comfortable with that word. But for a while, that wasn't really a comfortable word for me. I was definitely, I got to more of the spiritual side of Christianity, yeah. if anything.
Yeah, that's common. It how long do you think the whole process took you?
I mean, for myself, at least a year.
Okay. You know? That's kind of on the short side.
I think between maybe a year and a half in total, it was definitely almost a full year from my conversation with Anthony before I was saying out loud that I was an atheist.
Oh, okay. Yeah. So that's not bad. Now, my regular listeners know, and I don't know if you and I have talked about it, but I was in confirmation class at the age of 13 at the United Methodist Church. And, you know, if anyone would have asked me, I probably would have said I was a Christian, but goddamn, 13 years of age was a long fucking time ago now. But I do specifically remember asking questions and even talked to my parents, and they scheduled a time and I sat and talked to the youth minister for an hour, you know, one of the most
awkward conversations of my life, and all of our clothes did stay on. Thank you for asking. But, you know, he couldn't answer what I thought were basic questions. And then at the end, he said, just do it for your parents. And that was the moment in my head that I was like, oh, this is all a game. And that was the moment I adopted the atheist moniker, because I thought it was all stupid. But most people don't have that at 13. Most people, it's longer and it can be more painful. And how did friends and family handle you deconstructing?
Yeah. So, you know, when I started bringing up like New Testament scholarship in our Bible studies and stuff, I think maybe people were getting suspicious. You know what I mean?
You knew too much.
Yeah, I'm doing too much. When you start to put too academic of a lens on things, I think people were kind of wondering where I was at, right?
Yeah.
Because that's not typical. Like, regular Christians don't do that. And you know this. Anybody that's grown up in the church really knows this. Unless you have a very particular background, it's whatever the Bible says. You're not looking at what historians say about the Bible.
Yeah, and I'll even say it's whatever the minister tells you the Bible says.
Sure, sure.
Or the priest or the pastor or whatever.
That element too. So I think when I was, it was kind of like I was figuring out stuff for myself, and people were kind of, you know, seeing that change in me. And I think it was weird. And then when I finally realized, okay, I think I am just an atheist, I still kept going to church for a little bit, Phil, because I didn't have anywhere else to go.
Yeah.
I mean, this was my life.
Yeah.
Right. I thought God was going to give me a path in working through like Christian nonprofits, you know, or something. I really thought this was what I could dedicate my life and talents to, because that was the narrative I had been telling myself my entire life. So what do you do when you just suddenly realize none of this stuff is real, but literally everybody in your life is a part of this thing, right? So that was really hard. I started getting involved with the Atheist Community of Austin. And I was call screening for the Atheist Experience, and I would literally drive from Waco to Austin like every weekend just to hang out with folks.
And it's only this far on a map. I mean, right? They're really close.
It's an hour and a half drive.
Yeah.
You know,
that's nothing in Texas.
Nothing for Texas, but a lot when you're in college.
Yeah.
And you don't have a whole lot of cash, and also you put miles in your car and stuff.
Yeah.
And people are asking, hey, what are you doing on your weekends, or where are you going? You know, I would literally lie to my parents and say I was hanging out with like church friends sometimes.
Yeah.
You know, and eventually, you know, I couldn't keep living this kind of weird double life. At some point, actually, there was an incident at the church. I describe it as an incident. They wouldn't. It was at an event, and we were at somebody's house. We were celebrating something. I can't even remember what it was. But I just remember that they were talking about inviting this preacher who did gay conversion therapy camps speak at the church.
Yeah.
And I said, hey, actually, I don't think that's good at all, actually. I actually got kind of mad at that moment because I was really, you know, I was starting to become really good friends with folks in the LGBT community, which wasn't a relationship I had before, right? Because Christianity kind of prevented that. But like, you know, I was really learning at that time about the harms a lot of that stuff did. So I spoke up and I was like, hey, wow, that really concerns me, blah, blah, blah. And I'm having this conversation, and I'll never forget this, Phil. You know, a guy that was sort of the guy above me in leadership puts his hand on my shoulder and he says, maybe we can just talk about this another time.
Yep, shutting you down.
And I was like, we're never going to talk about this again because I'm going. because you don't want to have an honest conversation at that point. Right?
Right.
Like if you really believe, think about this. If this was a really life-saving camp, right? If you were actually doing a good thing, wouldn't you want to convince me of that? Like, wouldn't I, of all people, someone you've known for a long time, wouldn't you want to at least have a conversation about it? But no, I think I was saying stuff that they didn't know how to respond to.
Yeah.
Right? And maybe that's my characterization of it. But, you know, it's uncomfortable when people disagree with you like that. I walked away from the church and I never looked back.
Well, that's a lot like my my 13-year-old story when the minister said, well, just do it for your parents. I'm like, well, why don't you just tell me it's true?
Why don't you give me just some evidence? Don't tell me to do it for my parents, because then it clicked in my head that it was a game. It wasn't serious. And I think you kind of had the same vibe that you're like, well, hey, you know, if I'm the one who's wrong here, convince me. Don't tell me we're going to talk about it later. Wink, wink, nudge, because that just doesn't happen.
And I get it too. You know, like, it's a party setting. People don't want to start arguments and stuff. That's one thing. But this is a really serious thing, right?
Yeah.
Like, that's not something I could just... I thought being in the church environment, you know, at least having friends there, I wasn't doing any active harm, right? Like, for the last few months of that, I remember thinking it was just kind of weird. But, you know, these are my friends, and I don't have to tell them how I really think. I can just kind of get along. But at some point, I had to really think about, when am I culpable here, right? Like, when am I accountable for the actions that this church is doing?
Oh, dude, I can totally relate.
Part of it.
I'm sure you don't know, and again, I'll keep it brief because regular listeners, after we had kids and moved, I ended up being a board member for a Missouri Synod Lutheran Church school.
Mm.
And I actually was a very key part of them avoiding bankruptcy. So
I believe it.
There's a lot of people that put their kids in that school because I saved it. And that weighed heavy on me, I know for sure. So I can relate to what you're doing, you know, and you're thinking at some point, you're not just going along. At some point, somebody gets hurt and you were propping up the system by participating.
Yeah. And I think that's hard for me because, again, like, I had to, at that point, I really did leave kind of everything, right?
Yeah.
Like, I was already PMO. I was already physically and mentally out, right? Maybe you heard this before. But, like, at that point, I had to be physically out because I just couldn't justify it to myself anymore at that point. And, well, I don't know if I thought the church was evil or anything like that. I did think that it took advantage of passive people. Right? Because there's going to be the people that have really strong feelings, the ones who are really like, yeah, this conversion therapy thing is great, you know? And then there's the ones who are going to be neutral about it.
Yeah.
But they're all part of the same church.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Right. They're all donating money.
Yeah. Yeah. So that was really hard. So yeah. And of course, you know, at that time, I pretty much hadn't communicated with anybody from my church background, save one really good friend who I still talk to this day. But at that point, I was really cutting ties. And I started to get more involved with activism. I was kind of doing a podcast with Anthony Magnabosco at the time. And then I was kind of getting it more into this whole talking on the internet thing. And then eventually I pitched the idea for Truth Wanted. At the time, if you recall, conspiracy theories were becoming a cornerstone of our political discourse.
Yeah,
it wasn't just
some guy's
opinion from a basement anymore.
Yeah, I'm sadly aware of all of that. It's a painful thing to see, and atheists are not immune from it either.
Yes, yes. And so I thought, like, I saw atheist experience, and I was like, I can do this even better. I really did think that because, yeah, they talk about atheism and stuff, but what about the 90% of other shit that's out there? You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, you know, a lot, and I love, you know, obviously I do stuff with the atheist community in Boston. Atheist experience is great, but it's mostly Christian issues, right? I wanted to talk more about these kind of broader issues that were out there and showing how, like, street epistemology in particular, and just using some critical thinking stuff can really gauge that conversation. So that was kind of the inspiration there. It was kind of a combination of using the call-in show resources that the atheist community of Austin had, and also the street epistemology format, which hadn't been done in a call-in show at that point.
Because I know, and you, of course, correctly pointed it out when I was on the show, that let's just say I'm a little more direct than you are. You are often letting people talk and explain things, and you're just asking probing questions where I'm not quite, but I'm much closer to the, are you fucking nuts?
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
And it's one of those things that, like,
one of the times I was on the Atheist Experience when someone calls and wants to do the Kalam argument, and I'm like, no, yeah, I can't. I've done this too many times. Or when I run into a, you know, freshman college student and they say, you know, they want to have this big, meaningful talk about the difference between capital T truth and small t truth. And I'm like, no, like, I can't. I know it's new and exciting for you, but no, I can't.
Yeah. Yeah. And you know, believe me, I'm jaded as well. Okay. Like, it's not like I'm hearing new stuff every week. Yeah. Sometimes I do, but a lot of it's the same stuff too. But here's what I think about Phil. And I'm not saying I'm a saint either, by the way. I get frustrated. I get mad. I lose patience. Yeah. But Anthony Magnabosco gave more than 30 minutes of his time to me.
Right.
And in nowhere in that amount of time did I feel belittled, did I feel less than, did I feel like an idiot. All I got was, wow, this dude is asking some really amazing questions. And you know who were really mean was the comment section of that video.
There were people, holy shit,
call me
man.
Dumb. Call yeah. me stupid. Call yeah. me an idiot.
YouTube is not where you go to get compliments.
No, but Anthony genuinely, Phil,
yeah,
really changed my mind about who atheists could be.
Yeah.
Because my stereotype at that point was folks like Richard Dawkins
yeah.
and stuff, right? Like, just the most belligerent people out there. And yeah, atheists have fucking earned that reputation because it seems like even in the smaller circles, like, I still see that kind of attitude. And it's not to say that I don't think it's justified. Okay, let me be super clear.
Yeah.
I'm not saying that there are evils in the world don't deserve to be called out and don't deserve to be discussed and put down, quite frankly. But we're talking about dealing with other human beings, right? It's just not that simple. You can't always just tell someone, hey, this is stupid. Stop believing this. Like, well, it's just not how people work, right?
It was for...
Unfortunately, it takes time, you know? Yeah. And I want to try to give people that patience the same way it was given to me. But it's a really difficult thing. It's really hard.
Yeah, yeah. I understand. And it used to be, like, when I started doing atheism stuff, I was almost always the youngest guy in the room. And I was taking the mm-hmm. position that you were taking. But I had a lot of people who'd been around or... You know, like people would tell me the first time they could ever safely go to an atheist meeting was after they retired, because their entire working career, their entire friendship structure, their entire family structure would be destroyed the very mm. moment that those mm. words came across their lips. So
yeah,
you didn't get gentle atheist because they stayed hiding. The
yeah.
people that
yeah.
were willing to come out were the ones who were just on the small hilltops screaming, it's all bullshit, motherfuckers. Can't you see it? Because their life was diminished because of religion, and they finally could force through. Where in today's world, I think it's still very, very difficult for a lot of people. But there are many people that can come out and go to a group or find a place on Facebook or Meetup or some other thing where they can talk to people. So I think it's a growth of the concept where it's a kinder, mm. gentler thing where you're not only getting the people that had, I don't know, I wouldn't say the fortitude, the brass to jump out and speak out loudly against what they were trapped in. Now you have people that, you know, spent a year and a half or two questioning and they didn't deconvert, as you said. It wasn't this rejection of everything. You're looking at things one at a time, and it's this logical progression. And that's a much
yeah.
more accepted thing, at least for someone who's under 30. You are under 30, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm 28.
Yeah. Well, that's under 30.
And it's funny you say you're the youngest, because when I first was a host at the Atheist Community of Austin, I was the youngest host, and I'm still the youngest host at the Atheist
yeah.
Austin,
yeah.
which is really funny. But no, you're definitely right. I am a product of a privileged time, because I had access to resources like the fucking internet and
yeah.
you know, the communities and stuff that now exist that didn't a couple decades ago, right? I'm very, very, very lucky. And I definitely try to recognize that. And I totally understand the place that it has to be belligerent, to be really outspoken about some of this stuff, because it is necessary. I absolutely 100% believe it. Please don't misconstrue me saying that there's caveats there as it's not worthy of an endeavor. It definitely is. It's just when I was first getting into the space 6 years ago now, there really wasn't folks trying to do what I think I'm trying to do, which is just like, I don't know, meeting people where they're at,
right,
and kind of taking it as it comes.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
I think there is a place for that. There's a place for the street epistemology, talking to people and creating an open space where they can talk and they just answer questions. Big advocate for that. But I'm also a big advocate for every once in a while, I've heard stories from probably hundreds of people who've left religion, and a good chunk of them, I don't know if it's 10% or 20%, will say to me something like, at some point, someone called bullshit on what I was saying, and it fucking pissed me off. And so I decided I was going to dig in deeper to the Bible, and I was going to come back and make them eat their words for making me sound stupid. Mm-hmm. And then that set them on a path where they're like, oh, shit.
Yeah.
So there's no one right way. And I love for people to have a place where they can go talk and talk it out and hear people talking it out, because the really important part, and I'm assuming you know this, of course, it's not the people that call in, because you can only get a few every episode. It's the 100,000 people that might listen to a specific episode.
Oh, yeah.
That go, huh, that guy had some good thoughts and some good questions. The way I jokingly say it is that, one of the problems, or one of the huge giant perks of the internet, is you can find anything. One of the biggest problems also of the internet is you can find anything. And so I had once had a dream. My dream was that once so much stuff was seen as bullshit and scams, and you can't reliably count on any email that you get, no matter how good it looks, being actually legitimate. You've got to question your own fucking sanity with every email that you get. Is this legitimate? Can I click on this? How else can I find out this information without going through the link in the email? That would develop an entire new generation that questioned everything. It didn't. And I run into a lot of the two things that came up. One, thankfully, has faded some, was 9/11 truthers. And there were a considerable portion of atheists that were 9/11 truthers. And I've also run into atheists that are flat earthers. And I'm like, how? How is that something you could even entertain in your mind after you've already given up on religion or seen your way out of the lies of religion? How do you end up with flat earth being something you want to promote?
Yeah. I think about this too, because when you look at demographics, I think a lot of people expected that the younger generation would be more atheist. And that's kind of true,
yeah.
But it also kind of isn't. Like, I think, if anything, there's just a more general spirituality with younger generations than I think what people expected. We live in an age of great individualism.
Yeah.
And I think people are expressing themselves spiritually in ways that don't necessarily conform with the traditions of, say, the Christian church.
Yes. Yes.
And are maybe exploring themselves and using a language that co-opts spirituality to kind of talk about their own human experiences. But it's not the same as an organized sense. It's definitely true that there's less people in organized religion. That's true. But religiosity, yeah, I don't think that's changed as much as people might have expected. I really think it comes down to finding new avenues for people to have their own small groups of beliefs, like witches and flat earth folks, and,
right,
that kind
and there's definitely merit to that. I want to ask you, when you were last in school, whatever school that was, doesn't matter, what percentage of your grade, your cohorts, people who are going to graduate the same year as you, what percent do you think would have identified as atheists?
Well, it's not like I was going around surveying my classmates on their religion, right?
Yeah.
I don't think, here's the thing too, I think I don't think they'd really use the word atheist. I think atheist is still a bad word in a lot of people's minds.
Yeah.
I think there's a lot of people who, if you look on paper what they believe or don't believe,
right,
you would say, oh yeah, that's an atheist, but they wouldn't call themselves that.
Fair enough. Well, what percent would be nuns?
Nuns, at least, I would say maybe 20% at least.
Okay.
As a floor. I think it's slower than what people would think, because we are having a trouble. First of all, religion has always been rife with definitional issues, right?
Yeah.
What do we call religion versus don't call religion? Spirituality, right, is rife with this kind of perplexing sort of demarcation problem, right? Because of, again, there's a lot of people, smart people, who would say, oh, atheists are religious because XYZ. And it's like, yeah, I think that's bullshit. But, you know, there's a lot of people that have that mindset. So
now, I also fascinated by the fact that where you grew up, Waco, Texas, is not necessarily known as the free thought capital of North America.
No, it's not. Definitely not. No.
Because I distinctly remember when my daughter was in eighth grade telling me that somewhere between 25 and 45% of the students were atheists.
Mm.
Because she actually wore a red rubber bracelet from American Atheists to school. And people would ask her about it, and she'd tell them, they go, oh, I'm with you. I'm an atheist too. And
how long ago was this?
Well, I'm curious. She's your age.
Okay.
Right?
Because I'm a young millennial.
Yeah.
Really. So, I'm almost Gen Z. I'm not quite.
And then my son, who is your age also, I mean, they're only a year and a half apart, so I think he's a little older than you, and my daughter's a little younger than you. But my son went to a magnet school.
Okay, yeah.
The science and everything that, you had to get through the hurdles to get in, and you had to do really well academically with grades and tests and all that stuff. And at some point I asked him about his school, and he's like, yeah, 80, 90% of the kids there think religion is a joke and a con and a scam, and they're all they're almost all atheists. And the ones that are religious know to keep their mouths shut, because as soon as they say something, the kids are just going to rip them, because it's so obviously ludicrous to his classmates. So I was just kind of fascinated how different that was from you, for you. And of course,
yeah,
everybody's different.
It's a culture. I mean, because like the most popular after school activity at my high school was probably youth group.
Okay. Well, I was going to say drinking, fornication, a youth group. Oh, okay. Yeah.
Yeah. You know, like, I mean, that definitely happened, but like, I don't think that was most kids. I mean,
yeah.
I could be completely off base, to be fair.
Yeah.
I'm purely speaking on anecdote. And maybe that's my Christian bias that's happening there too, where I'm thinking everybody thinks the way I do.
Did they have purity rings in your high school?
There are definitely kids. Yeah.
Oh my God.
I didn't do purity rings.
No, my kids in the schools they were in, you would have worn that one day, and you would have been shunned into taking that off and never bringing it back to school.
Oh yeah. See, it wasn't like that. We definitely had like magazines for catalogs for purity rings and stuff people pass around and stuff.
Oh my God.
That was definitely a thing. Yeah.
Yes.
You know, I grew up in Waco, Texas.
Yeah. Yeah. Though, yeah.
You know,
so
it's a very different world.
Well,
right?
And that's why I love talking to so many people about their deconversion or their destruction.
Yeah.
Deconstruction. Because everybody's story is different, and there's a lot of people that your show, Truth Wanted, by the way, everybody, Truth Wanted, go check it out, and that are going to listen to that and be affected. And I'm delighted that you're there doing that. So I just want to, you know, is there a way that people can reach you, like if someone's running a conference or wants you on their podcast? Because I'm about lifting all boats. Is there a way people can reach you to help you be on more stuff?
Yeah, absolutely. Like you, it's so funny because you contacted me on my Facebook page, and I never look at my Facebook page.
Yeah,
but
that's very common for a 28-year-old. Yeah.
It's true. That's also true. I still have a Twitter account that I have not been posting to recently, but I do look at the DMs. So if you want to follow me on Twitter at ObjectivelyDan or X, you know, whatever the fuck they want to call it these days, you know, that's where you can kind of direct message me. But yeah, like Truth Wanted, I do an association with the Atheist Community of Austin. So I don't make any money off of that. If you're interested in supporting me, Zadanza is my only for-profit venture right now. And I say for-profit, really the Patreon money we get is to cover like subscription fees and stuff like that.
Well,
like,
give us that name again slowly.
Yeah, Zadanza. It's ZODANZA. It's a combination of Prophet Azad and Objectively Dan. We went with Zadanza. So that's my big project I'm putting a lot of time into right now.
Yeah.
But yeah, I appreciate you willing to shout me out, Phil, because you know, I love doing this stuff. I would do this, like, you know, Zadanza is the first thing I've done where I've actually gotten any money back from stuff I've done. But even if I wasn't doing that, I feel spiritually called to this work, Phil.
There you go. It's your calling. Power. Well, I had at some point ran ads on my show, and I even got a Patreon, but for me it didn't feel right because I'm doing well, right? So it wasn't. Mm-hmm. I decided I shut it off, and anyone that listens to my show, I tell them all the time to go give money somewhere else. I don't need it. I don't need your $5 a month. I don't need your $20 a month. Whatever. Should I collect it because it's collectible? One could argue that I should, because it wasn't very much work to have a Patreon page. But I would rather that money be contributed to people who are doing something different than me that might stop if they can't afford to do it. So I'm delighted that you are now learning ways to bring in revenue so that you can continue to do it. And hopefully, hopefully you're doing it for the fun in and of itself, but it's also nice to make money doing things. That's kind
of
cool.
I mean, when we're talking about making money again, it's not a lot. Like I work a full-time job, and everything that I've gotten so far has, again, just been enough to cover like my Adobe subscription and like StreamYard, like, you know, just like the basic stuff. But no, I totally get you. I've also been privileged too, again, because the Atheist Community of Austin, like if there's a conference or something that they want to be represented, and you know, they're able to like get me to, you know, paid for, you know, hotel or whatever to do stuff with that. So like I've been very privileged in a lot of ways to do the activist work that I do. But yeah, it is, I agree with you, Phil. It's like, it is kind of weird when you got patrons and stuff. It's like, oh man, you guys are like really nice. Why are you giving money to me? You know what I mean?
Yeah. It's a funny world, and there's strategies for everybody. And I love that you're doing that. And everybody, once again, Truth Wanted is the biggest platform, part of the ACA, Atheist Community of Austin. Anything you want to go over or we didn't cover, you want to get in before we wrap up?
No, Phil, just thank you for your time. If you're looking for a good place to start, let's do this. If you're looking for a good place to start, I'll go watch the one with me and Phil.
There you go.
If you like that one, go watch the last one me and Phil did. And if you like that one, do the one before, because I think we've done three episodes together now.
I think so. And of course, I'm on other YouTube podcast thingies as well. So because that happens from time to time. I'm always honored when someone has me on their show. So I appreciate you. Let me play along on Truth Wanted. And of course, I'm delighted that you came and spent some time with my listeners here on The Phil Ferguson Show.
Absolutely, Phil. Thank you for your time.
I am so glad you're still here listening to The Phil Ferguson Show. If you like the show, go give a 5-star review somewhere. I appreciate those very, very much. Thank you for all the people that have done that. Of course, you can share the show with a friend. It is the most awesome thing ever when I get an email from somebody that said, hey, I was at this event and I was talking to somebody, or I was at a friend's house talking to them, and I said, you should listen to this show, The Phil Ferguson Show. And they go, oh my God, I listened to that show already. How freaking cool is that? I am so honored. I am so humbled that people like the show to come back to listen a second time, or 20th time, or in some cases, because this is show 488. I still get these emails where someone says, hey, I just listened to every one of your episodes. Are you fucking serious? I don't know that I could do that. I mean, I've heard them all already, so I guess that puts me at a disadvantage, but wow. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much. I can't tell you how much I appreciate it. The other thing that happened recently is I had someone contact me and they said that they looked at all of the mutual funds that I recommend and they've done terribly. How can I continue to do what I'm doing? And I thought, what? I was dumbfounded. I'm hoping that they were just being an idiot or that they thought it was to be funny, to be a joke. But I'm using primarily US-based Vanguard index funds, different segments of the market, but collectively they match the market with a little bit of luck and rebalancing and correct allocations. We can squeak out a little bit more from the performance. I think they were also confused about the use of bonds, because bonds over the last decade, depending on which bond fund you're in, might have made 2, 3, 4, 5% a year. If you're comparing that to a stock mutual fund and saying, well, this only made 2 or 3%. Yeah, no shit, Sherlock. I know how that works. I do that for a reason. And I recommend against it for a reason. As example, if you're 25 or 30 or 35, you should take on the full risk of the market. You should understand the full risk of the market. And if you're comfortable with that risk, take it on. But you're going to make the most money in the long run. But for many people, and this is very important, the difference for everybody is important. You probably want something that's a little more conservative when you get closer to or you're in retirement. My dad is an extreme outlier example, because my dad and my mom, they're in their head, the bulk of the money that they had made over their entire lives and invested and saved was for their sons, which, yay for me and my brothers, but I really do wish they spent more before they passed away. But they had 90% of all their retirement portfolios in stock in their 80s. That was by choice. Now, my dad happened to have a couple of pensions. One was pretty juicy. They both had Social Security, and they both worked part-time just to keep themselves busy and to make a little bit of money up until the last few years before their deaths. And they took out very small amount of their portfolio. We're talking about like 2%, which is basically bond and stock dividends. So even if the market went down per se, they were still getting similar dividend levels, dividend dollar amounts. So there wasn't a whole lot of risk to their cash flow. And when you're taking out 2%, you can always take out 3% or 4% if you need to for a year or two. Or you could cut it perhaps if you have other sources of income and get by for a year or two. And they were in that position. I'm expecting to be a little more balanced myself and spend more of my money and travel and see things. But it depends on your situation. It depends on your goals. And this is one of those things that the industry standard default is 40% bonds, 60% stocks. I tend to push down to a smaller percentage in bonds, 35, 30, and in some extreme cases, if it's the right client or the right person, even lower than that. I want the bond portfolio to be as big as necessary, but as small as possible. And it will cover you in the down years of the stock market. And the smaller you make the bond portfolio, the larger your long-term returns are probably going to be. But the more risk that you take, that in any given year, you might have to tap into it. So it's this complicated scales, you know, teeter-totter, whatever, seesaw, whatever you want to call it. Anyway, so I was very confused, I guess, by the email, because I don't know if this person understands or has followed the show or listens to the show or has listened enough to understand the basics of what I'm trying to do here. But anyway, enough of that. It's already a long show. It is now getting freakishly hot here in Florida, and I close up my office to record, so there's very little background noise, and it becomes a sweat box. So I am now sweating for you folks, and I'm going to wrap up the show, open the doors, turn on the fans, run the air conditioner some more. And if you have questions, show ideas, or if you've happened to stumble across a church budget of some kind, you can send it to phil@polarisfinancialplanning.com. I do have plans to be at Baja Con this later this summer. Feels like summer now. It's April in Florida. In Canada, in Sarnia, Canada, right across from Detroit. Get tickets if you can, if it's not sold out already. I will be at the FFRF conference. I will be at the CFI conference, which is called CSI Con, and maybe some other events during the year. So if you do happen to see me out there in person, please feel free to come up and say hello. And until then, ciao.
Confessed Christ as Lord.